What's up, Backgammon fans? This is Mark Olsen from BackgammonGalaxy.com. Let's do some commentary while playing. Okay, 5-4. Standard opening. Split the back checkers so you don't get trapped. Feel free to ask questions in the comment section. I'll try to keep up with your questions or comments. Okay, 6-2. What's this? Okay, I think I gotta get this one out, away from the stack. And, I could also play this deuce, actually. So what about... This one keeps connectivity with the back checkers, but it's a bit more exposed. Let's try this one. It's a Danish guy. I'm not really sure what he means with this comment. I'm just gonna tell him that we're live streaming. And wish him a good match. Okay, 4-2. Okay, I make the 4 point, of course. Don't mind leaving that shot on the 14 point. I gotta make the 4 point, of course. 5-4. Okay, he hits in my face. Oof, I fan. That's not good. At least he didn't double. I think he's correct in not doubling. Let's see if I fan again. Good. I didn't fan. Okay, so I kind of want to hit him to take away the initiative, but it's too deep to the deuce point. So what about this move? I don't like the daily builder on the 4, but what else do I have? I can make a loose hit. No, okay, so this is the 2 first fours. What about this play? Yeah, let's make the tempo move. I'm scared of his blitz. Okay, I don't think this is a cube, so I'm gonna say thank you very much and take this cube. The race is completely even. He's on the bar and he doesn't have a closed prime position at all. I can easily survive this blitz. Oh, that's a hit, and the game is basically turned around. That's a good one, double aces, because it closes the gap on the five point and unstacks his heavy 6 point. Hey, Paul Whittaker, he says, hey Lee, hey Mark. Okay, I don't know who Lee is. Maybe my opponent's name is Lee, I don't know. Okay, he just got a big developing role in double aces, so... Ooh, 6-1, I'd like to make my 5 point, but it's too much. He has the stronger inner board, so I must play safe. And I anchor up. I hope that my opponent doesn't listen to this live stream. I should put in a longer lag. Okay, what's this? Still no cube, of course. He has a very strong front position. 4-2. I'd like to build my 4 point, but that leaves a shot. So let me just decrease on the number of shots by hitting and also gain more in the race by hitting. Aha, he fans. So now I'm looking at the recube. It's a 5 point match. He still has a very strong front position. Could be a recube though. Could be a recube. I'm up 20 pips, but I'm underdeveloped. That's a problem. It's quite easy to take this cube, I believe. And if he takes, my gammon value goes down. Since it's just a 5 point match, my threes are duplicated. Let's take a roll. My opponent says no double take. Then that probably means that he's scared that I'm gonna cube him. I guess so. Okay, 6-4, that's one of my weaker rolls. I guess the 4 comes down to the 9 point, and let's just play like this. Okay, what about this one? This could be a cube. This could be a cube. Up in the race, I have a lot of threats here. He has two blots. But again, I have a long way home. He has a lot of contact value. Let's take a roll. 6-1, that's a poor shot. I guess, yeah, I have to do like this. I have to do like this. I'm happy that I didn't roll, that I didn't cube. Let's have a look at this one. His double fives, it's actually a bad number since he has to, he can't develop his back checkers. They're stuck. So he has to move some destructive pips down in his, deep in his inner board. So perhaps I have a cube now. I think I have actually. The problem is this ugly dilly builder I have on the deuce point. That's really ugly. But his problem is now that he just made a crunching move. Wow, I think that was a mistake. He could have just cleared the, he could have just cleared the midpoint and kept his position. So now I want to double. Since he crunched his front position, he snap takes. He snap takes. So what do I do? Do I keep the 5 prime? Or do I just make this blitzy, blitzy, blitzy? This gives him more bad shots, I think. Rolls like 3-5, 5-5-2. And if I don't blitz, I just make this prime move, then he can make the anchor. I'm not sure. It's a little bit difficult. Let's keep the prime. My biggest fear now is that he gets a 3, since he could make the anchor on my 4 point. However, since his front position is completely destroyed, it's much not much of a threat. Okay, let's go for the blitz here. Let's go for the blitz. I gotta watch my time. It's not easy commentating and playing backgammon. Keep 5 point. And split. Ooh, okay. Tiberio Boston had a good point. We could have split with the double aces. I think it's a bit too much, Tiberio, to split, because it does leave him some shot, some chance of hitting me, and he still has a 4-point board. And then getting his checkers home while I'm on the bar. But I like the idea. I like the idea. It might be the right idea. Okay, let's play aggressive for the gammon. I'm gonna try to pick up the third one as well. Okay, he gets loggy. He enters fast. 6-1. Don't leave any shots. I'm trying to go. Still trying to go for the gammon. It's not that important with the gammon, since it would only win me one extra point from 4-0 Crawford. No reason to make the pay now. That's a good one. Okay, do I play for the gammon? He's completely crunched. I think I just play it safe. I don't have full value on the gammon, and it seems to me that he's a big favorite to win the gammon, to save the gammon anyway. So let's just play it safe and get the 4 points. Usually a good rule of thumb is that when your opponent has crunched his position, then you can be extremely aggressive in your bear off. However, he's not completely crunched. He has a 4-point board now. And yeah. But it's a good rule of thumb. As soon as your opponent has crunched his front position, you can be aggressive in your bear off. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he saves the gammon. He saves the gammon. And I'm gonna be up 4-0. Easy take. Your 4-cube. I'm not sure it was an easy take, this 4-cube, because his front precision was crunched. So I don't think he should have taken that cube. We're gonna see after the match. I'm gonna run through the big decisions. Okay, so this is one of those moves where I like to creep up with a back checker rather than go all the way to the 21 point, since he's thin out here on his 7 and 8 point. Then it makes sense to come up with a back checker. 3-6. Okay, I really want to hit, but if I hit, then I can't make the 5. So I gotta make the 5. 3-1. He could double hit. He could double hit, even though that. Oh, shit. Even though the double hit is quite weak because his checkers in the zone here are so thin. Such few checkers, so the blitzing moves are quite weak. 5-1. I guess that's a good shot. How to play it? This is gonna be the ace, so do I make the prime move? I guess so. Or do I make the blitzing move? I have 9 checkers in the zone. That's not too much. So I think I want to just make the prime move. If I had more checkers, I would probably just blitz. 3-1. Make the anchor. Right? The hit is too big. I think the hit is too big. Just make the anchor. Five three. What? Ah, okay. Fair enough. 4-3, that's a crappy roll. Huh. I gotta play it safe. Gotta stack the 6 point. I don't like it, but I didn't have any alternatives. Tiberio Boston is still curious about the split. Let's check it after the match, Tiberio. We'll go in the analysis mode and have a look. Okay, 2-1. That's a hit. I guess, right? I could also play it flexible. No, it's a hit. 4-2. That's a good shot. He makes the 21 point. What about this one? I could do like this. I'm up in the race. I don't care about losing gammon, so I guess that's my move. If I was playing gammon safe, maybe I wouldn't have left the anchor. But at this score, oh, he hit the fly shot. I was thinking that he should make my his 4 point. Oh, that's a good shot for deuce. Makes the anchor and unstacks the 6 point with a hit. Unluckily, I get hit in return. What's up with this 3-2? Okay, I'm kind of stuck behind his prime, so I actually want to play this, but I think I got a hit. I think I got a hit. I'm not sure about this hit because my main problem now is I'm getting primed and I can only escape with fives. Yeah, I have a problem here. I have a big problem. Guess I play like this. Notice that I'm not playing a back game here. It's way too even in the race to be playing a back game, and I'm still priming my opponent as well. Even though he's leading in the priming game, I still have some prime value going on, so definitely not a back game position. Even though I'm not thrilled about stacking this 4 point of his. Okay. He thinks that I'm resigning the game? Really? I don't think so. He's just joking. Okay, he's joking. Nice one. Let me just slot. Let me just slot. Good luck. Maybe he's chatting just to make me spend more time. Okay, let's build. It's not too bad, this position. I have a little bit of race equity and some contact value from my anchor. And if I can just get a six within the next two rolls so I don't have to crunch, then it's not too bad. Yeah. He gets a double three. He's in a good shape in the race now. That's the six. Pretty good. Keeps my mobility going. I don't want to get stuck and end up crunching. Oh, that's not too good. That's not too good. It speeds up my crunch. Okay, double five. That's a poor roll. I'm not sure it's a poor roll, actually. He does clear the 8 point. He gains 20 pips in the race. So it's probably not that bad. Yeah, let's slot. 6-5. My contact value is increasing with his gaps. Oh, should I play this? 6-5. And I don't care losing it. I don't care losing the gammon. I think I should play this, the contact move. Get the reward on 6-5. I would get a triple shot. Okay. Looks like I'm gonna lose this game. Jesper Carlsen asked if my opponent knows that it's being live streamed, this match. I told him so in the beginning of the match, so he knows. And I think he's a Dane. I know most of the Danish players, but I probably know this guy as well, but I don't know who he is. He didn't tell us who he actually was in real life. Double three. Yeah, let's just save the gammon. Or not. Double six. Notice that I don't care too much about losing gammon at this score since it doesn't really matter post Crawford if he has 1 or 2 points. He's 2 wins away from winning the match anyway. Okay, and I have a. Oh, that's a funny one. Because I have a free pass here. And I should take when I win the opening roll, except with 4-1. So I think I should pass. I think XG 3-ply is going to give me an error for passing this cube. But I believe that the right idea is to pass it and to redo the opening roll. I'm a slight underdog after 4-1. Okay, that's a lot better. And of course, now I have a free take since I don't care if he has 3 or 4 points. He will be one game away from victory after the if he wins this game anyway. Double deuces. Haha. This is a classic one. No, you shouldn't make that move, my friend. No. That's the gammon save move he just made. He want to win the gammon. So he should make the 4 point at least and then consider the last two deuces. And I think the 11 point was the right idea. I'm just gonna run up 20 pips. He hits the fly shots. He hits the fly shot. Lucky. At least it's somewhat duplicated. He also like to make the 3 point. 4-2. I guess I have to hit to take away the initiative. If I do like this, I'm up in the race. Nah, let me just play it slow. Let's give him the initiative. He has a 1 point board. I'm not too scared. I can't do anything here. So let's just build some stuff. What to build? What to build? Let's play it tight. I'm gonna play it tight. I just spent some precious seconds on my time bank with that decision. It's a bit ugly to play this dilly builder to the 3 point, but I want to have a tight position right now because I might get a fly shot. Okay, I don't hit him, but I make this beautiful anger, so I'm quite happy. Anyway, very good roll. This is a very even position. He has a slight edge since he has complete freedom with his back checkers, and I don't. I still have the anger here on his bar point, but the race is super close. As we can see, I'm down 2 pips. Wow, that's gonna seal it. The double 5 to win the race, unless he does something amazing now with the dice. He still has a decent chance. I'm just gonna clear my back checkers since I'm up in the race. I'm gonna break contact. Let's get 2 crossovers. So now I'm thinking about having a in these barren positions, what you think about is trying to get like a triangle position like this, where you have used minimum effort to get your checkers into your board while still optimizing a well-distributed bear-off structure. So that's the idea. That's why you shouldn't just how to play these. Let's play it like this. Yeah, you shouldn't just only think about crossovers. You want to have a good distribution for the bear-off as well. And it seems he knows this strategy. He's playing the checkers well, I guess, in this race. I have a clear advantage, but it's definitely not a gin position. Let's see. Oof, that's a high roll. He's closing in. 5-1. Spreading out my distribution. 5-2, 2-1. Oof, that sucks. That sucks. 6-1. He's closed the gap. 6-5. What a strong roll. Powerful roll. Double 3. I think that seals it. Now he has to come up with something. Double aces. Not good enough, buddy. Not good enough. What do you think the error rates were, people? Let's see some guesses on the error rate in the live chat, in the comment section. 2-1. I'm jinxing it. I'm jinxing it. Out of play. Let's play it. How to play it? Let's play it like this. Let's see some guesses on the error rate. I am jinxing it. I'm not gonna win in this game. He's catching up. No, 6-5. What the fuck? Nah, I jinxed it. Fuck. I jinxed it. Jinxed it by telling you guys to guess on the error rates. Okay, now I have to play fast. Okay, the big split, double match point, checker play. You want to split your checkers in double match point. Lucky me. Okay. Double 3, he knows how to play the double 3, good. Aha! I could make the 5 point, but I opt for the advanced anchor. Aye, that's a fly shot. God damn it. Got lucky there. Yeah, I guess I gotta play something like this. Or what? No, can't do that. I gotta play flexible. Now he makes his 4 point in my face. That's a good shot. That's what I'm talking about. Now I'm in the lead. That's a poor one. What to do from here? 5-2. Oof, he fans. What a expensive fan. Okay, I could make the 3 point, but what about just making this beautiful prime structure when it's double match? He fans again. What? I could hit, or let me just close the 5 point. Let me just close the 5 points. Let's see if I can get a 6 prime this time. Compensation, bad luck. There it is, the 6-3 for the 6 prime. What a beautiful roll. Now he's in real trouble. You're in real trouble now, buddy. 6-4, he slots the 3. He does have some purity in his prime structure over here, which means that if he hits, if he gets a hit, he could end up repriming me instead of me priming him. Yes, but Carlson, biggest error to call it settled. Yes, 5-3, but I guess I play like this. I opted to move both of them. First of all, to duplicate the threes. Second of all, so he doesn't hit and slot the 7 point at the same time. Let's just move it like that. Double five, that's a bad roll. It speeds up his crunch, moves destructive pips in his front position. That's not what he wants to do. And this is hopefully gonna be an easy win for me now. I'm like a well beyond 90% favorite in this position. Since he has poor timing, and do I just slot it now? Or yeah, I guess I just slot it now. I'm not scared of his prime or his timing. Another double five. Yes, and look at this beautiful position. He's crunching his front position completely, fully crunched, and I'm just sliding in with all the smoothness in the world. This is gonna be an easy win, hopefully. I'm probably like a 95% favorite now. His contact value is so low because of his crunched front position. So even if he hits me, I'm gonna enter. Oi! Double five, that was a poor roll on my behalf. I leave him another shot. I jinxed it again. I jinxed it again. And now we have a scrambling home position. We have a scrambling home position. The six is forced, and let's just minimize the shots by moving the ace here. He gets the hit. Jesus Christ. Oh, fan. He's catching up in the race. It's gonna be close now. Luckily, I have four checkers off already, but I need to enter. I think I wanna maximize contact now. 5-2, that's a pick and pass. Give me an 8. Yeah, tack. Yeah, tack. That was a good hit. Okay, minimize shots, not an ace. Good. Good. Now I'm in the... Even though he's up in pips, I'm leading in the race big time. He has a lot of wastage here on his ace point, and he has 0 checkers off against my 5 checkers off. Okay, that's a bad shot, actually. How to play it? As long as I don't lose on time now. 9 seconds left. It's a race. You need some... He needs another double. He needs another double. And there it is. Error rates, guys. I didn't see any error rate guesses. Ah, that's nice. Lovely to see. Lovely to see the crown on my side. Grandmaster level. I'm living up to the expectation of my galaxy rating. And the winner crown up here for winning the match. That's good. We see my dear opponent actually played at expert level. He played quite well. Error rate of 5.2. The luck rating down here, I was a bit luckier than my opponent. Makes sense since I won the match. And I get some lovely galaxy rating points. So let's just say thanks to the opponent. Oh, why can't I say thanks? He probably already left. Okay, let's just look at the review some of the blunders here. Let's review some of the blunders. 3-1. That's a bad one. That's a bad one. He should make the 5 point. Why didn't he make the 5 point? What did he do? He played like this, split and down. At least he could have hit with the 3. Okay, that's a big one. That's not a good move. Yeah, you gotta make the 5 point or at least hit with the 3. Okay, what else? Double deuces for me. This decision. Yeah, I wasn't sure. I ended up making this ugly point shift, which is not a good idea unless you want to play the blitz game plan. And I don't want to play the blitz game plan here. The race is too long. I only have 9 checkers in the zone. It's not enough ammunition to make a blitz move. But what I was really scared of here was leaving all the initiative to my opponent, since he would be, after my move here, I come down, make the 11 point, and then play. After the right move, I would be scared of him hitting me with a deuce and this blitz structure here coming down to hit my blood on the 23 point. That was my logic, but it's a pretty robust strategy not to make blitz move when you don't have a blitz position. And that was the strategy rule that I violated in this position. And then my opponent doubled. Yes, I remember, and we already said that we didn't like it, and it's a big mistake to cube this position. It's a double blunder. He's on the bar, first of all. You need a very strong position if you want to cube while you're on the bar. The raise is even. He has a gap on his 5 point. He's stacked, so his efficiency is not that good. I mean, he doesn't really have much going on in this position. As we can see in the details here, he's just a 55% favorite. And yes, he wins more gammons, but it's almost a coin flip in this position. So it's big, big mistake to give me the cube here. Very easy to take. And now I have all the cube value. 2-1, he hits. Let's scroll fast. 6-2, he fails to. Okay. Yeah. First of all, my opponent needs to activate the back checkers. It's so weak to have 3 checkers on the 24 point. However, his move disconnects his back checkers, and you're still stuck with 2 disconnected checkers trapped on the 24. The best move would be make the split, the small split, and play this checker safe. The race is still quite even, so it's pretty bad if I hit him and gain race and allow to escape from my anger with a hit. Yeah. 4-2, make the right move. Yes, this one was a big one. My opponents chose to crunch his front position rather than just clear the midpoint. Always clear the midpoint before you crunch your front position. Let that be a lesson to you guys. Always clear the midpoint before crunching your front position. And he didn't here. He made a very, very ugly move that even gave me a cube. Even though I have a quite ugly structure as well, I'm stripped in the outfield. I have many gaps, 3 gaps in my prime, and I have a dilly builder on the deeply made deuce point. And I still have a long way to go with the 2 checkers on the 18 point. So if it wasn't for his crunched front position, I wouldn't be near a cube here. But the fact that he just made the crunching move, that allows for a cube. Let's see the detail. It's almost a pass. It could be a pass when you, if you roll it out. I'm 70% favorite with 20% gammon and some volatility, since I could make some blitzing moves. All my doubles that just blitz on the 4 point and make inner points, or even run to safety, or roll like 5-2 where it just point in his face and he doesn't enter making an anger. So cube when your opponent has crunched. That's the key. Okay, there we have it. Tiberio Bostan, that was your splitting move with the double aces. Let's see how it ranks. Okay, I like the idea, Tiberio, but it's a blunder. Since my opponent still has a 4 point board, I don't like giving him a free shot to just put me on the bar. If my structure were better, let's say I had a 6 prime, then it's a good idea to make the contact moves and hopefully try to pick up more bloods. But in this case, the right idea is just to make the prime and then just come up to the 17 point. I wasn't sure. I was waving a bit back and forth between the making the 4 point and making the best play. Luckily, I found the best play. 4-3. He makes the anger, of course. That's very crucial. But he continues to crunch. Double sixes. Okay. A very clear play. Of course, I got a blitz here. Yeah. Okay, it's actually not that bad to make something else. Like, what move is that? It's like this, and then make the 3 point. It's not that bad making this move. Aha. Keeping contact since he's crunched and just making the inner board. Yeah, okay, it makes sense. The blitzing move is still good though. Now I just want to bring my checkers home. Okay, I could have cleared the 8 point and just got to the 14 point, two checkers. That would be the preferred move by Extreme Gammon, but it's just a small detail. 4-2, I clear. He hits a fly shot, but I hit him back. He enters immediately to save. No, he doesn't save these blots. And I hit, yeah. And look at this one. I hit with a deuce, and then I stay there, and I bury a checker. Because he's on the bar, every time he fans, I get a free shot at picking up another blot, going for the gammon. So I could have played it safe, but I chose to make the aggressive gammon move, which is the right idea since I have a 5 point board and my opponent has a crunched 3 point board. That's the key. 6-1. I should have made the pay now. It kind of felt like a good play to make the pay now, but I was like, why make the pay now? I can just make it later. But it's true that you decrease your flexibility a lot by playing 5-1, and you could even win the gammon if you make the pay now and he has to break his anchor to make the hit with a 3. So why not just play the flexible move when your opponent is this weak? Okay, cool. I accept that mistake. Learning something. Okay, this one. It's a toss-up. It's close. I felt it was close as well. Whether you play aggressively to bear off, which you usually do when your opponent is crunched, or you just play it safe. It's very close decision here, as we can see. The reason is that... The reason is that the gammon value at a 5 point match is quite low, because you only win one extra point. So the additional amount of gammon you would go from making my move to the best move, 22 to 34. It's you don't utilize all that extra when gammon wins. That's why it's close. Yeah. And then that's it. Let's go to the next game. Four. Oh, 6-3. Yeah, you make the 5. Okay, I had a decision here, small error. I chose to make the hit, but I didn't have to make the hit. I'm already up in the race. Leave him less good numbers and just play it flexible. Yeah, okay, I like the Extreme Gammon move now, actually. It's a small detail. Usually the hit is good. Here I shouldn't hit for sure. Just make the anchor. Yes, I made a blunder here. 2-1. I made the hit and then I went back and I said, no, maybe I should just play it flexible since I'm already in a close race. And my problem is that I'm getting primed down here. And I'm not really gaining a lot from this hit. Okay, so this is too much. It's an inefficient hit. Another detail is that when your opponent has an anchor on the 23 point, I'm actually priming him quite well right now with this structure. He can only escape with a 5, basically. That's his only direct escape. Whereas if I send back another checker, he gets more flexibility to come in from the bar and make an advanced anchor here, or have back checker split to have more flexibility to escape or cover the outfield. So that's a small detail, actually. When your opponent is getting primed on an angle like this, sometimes you don't want to send the third checker back because it just leaves him more flexibility with the back checkers. But the key is that I'm getting primed over here and I need to mobilize those checkers. The best way is to get it up there so I can use that spare checker to jump with the 5 next time. I don't want to be forced to leave my anger with a 5 and open up for all the blitz value that he has in this structure here. Okay. 6-5, that's a good play, of course. I don't care about losing Gammon in post-Crawford score, 4-0. So just improve my prime structure and escape a back checker. 6-3, he hits the outfield shot. Okay, I make a small error. I like this roll actually while I was playing, because I could come in and I could unstack with a hit. But the idea is simply, again, just to make sure that you have that spare checker that's ready to run, so you preserve mobility. Ah, okay, it's not that big of a deal actually. I did like unstacking, making the aggressive prime move. 4-3. I make another small mistake here. Another big decision. Ah, okay. Aha, look at this move. The machine finds. What a beautiful move. I like it. It's efficient since it unstacks. It's pure because you slot the next point you want to make. And you have flexibility over here with your back checkers to escape both with 5s and 6s. My move is a bit too stiff because I enter on the 23 point and then make the hit. First of all, it sucks to get hit in return from the bar. And second of all, I don't have the flexibility with my back checkers. I'm getting primed big time with this structure over here. I can only jump with 5s, and that would even I would have to break my anchor on the 24 point to do so. I really, really like Extreme Gammon's move here, but I didn't see it over the board. I wish if I'd seen it, maybe I could have found the best move. Double deuces, that's a good shot. That's not too good. Aha, okay, I remember my opponent gave me a comment here. I think he was making a joke. I'm not playing a back game because the race is way too even. I don't have the timing and I'm still playing a front game, right? I still have some prime value going on here. Priming his back checkers, he has to run with one of them and I can attack and stuff like that. He could roll a double 4 that crunches. So I am not playing a back game. Therefore, let's just get those checkers up to the 21 point and have him ready to escape with 5s. Double aces. Okay, that's a classic decision. Do you block the 6s or do you increase your purity and block the 5s instead? You prefer to block the bigger numbers, but you also prefer to have a pure prime structure. So he made the right move here by making the 5 prime. I crunch a bit, but I slot. I continue to play pure. Notice that I didn't make the ace point here. That would decrease my prime value in the long run. I just play pure as possible, slotting the 3 and the deuce. And if he escapes a checker later on, I will have a purer board rather than have the ace point made. After you make the ace point, all your prime value basically disappears. He escapes with this back checkers. That's a good move. I miss, and I even miss the 6, and then it's just like this. Okay, and we get into a holding game. This one. Okay, it's a close decision. Small error. Extreme Gammon just wants to run all the way. I opted for the contact move. Make the 5 point and get the reward of a triple shot if he rolls the 6-5. But it's kind of annoying to get hit because then I would be on the bar and he would drag in his checkers. Not so much about losing the Gammon, it's more about losing contact value since I would be on the bar. Double 4s and then nothing really going on here. Ah, he makes a mistake. Aha! He didn't bear off aggressively. He didn't bear off aggressively. Again, because I'm crunched a bit, I'm not even crunched that much, but I'm crunched a little bit with my 4-point open and these dead checkers up here. That allows him to just play it aggressively. And then he wins. Let's go to game number 3. He doubles, and as I expected, XG 3-ply gives me an error for dropping this cube after 4-1, but I believe that after the rollout, you come out as an underdog with a 4-1 opening roll. 4-1 and 2-1 are the two worst, so I don't mind. I don't mind. I give it up and then I get a good opening roll instead in the next game. And then he doubles and I have a free take. And this is the blunder we talked about with the double deuces. He's playing a Gammon Go score now because his Gammons wins him the match. So obviously he shouldn't play the gammon save move here. He should just make the offensive move, the 4 point and the 11 point. Yeah, the 11 point. That's the right idea. Let's see, I'm curious which move of the 11 point or the 22 point that wins more games. Let's see the winning chances. Yeah, it's just the 11 point every day of the week. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Even splitting is better. Okay, double five. I get off to a bad start here. I run, I'm up in the race, he hits me. That's where the game changed a bit. Now I have a slight disadvantage. Ah, okay, this 4-2. I should have made the hit. I wasn't sure at all. And I was down on time. Only had like 16 seconds left. So I opted just for the quiet play, the efficient unstacking, keeping my points. The problem is, however, that I'm leaving all the initiative and my opponent has 11 checkers in the zone here and as well, he has initiative to escape his back checker. So it's pretty good. I have the stronger inner board, 2 point board versus 1 point board. I could have made the aggressive hit here. 6-4, that's a little bit awkward. He misplays it though. He could have made the 5 point. But he chose to run and make the 9 point. That's a mistake. That's a half a blunder. You gotta make the 5 point. It's too good. He's still playing the gammon go. 5-4. Oh, that's a good decision I made here. I play tight. I'm not gonna slot when we have an hit exchange upcoming. So I just play it tight with my front position. Even though I don't like this dilly builder on the 3 point. 6-3, now he makes the 5. That's a good shot, 6-3, to make the advanced anchor. And he can't even play it safe here. So I get the shot. I don't hit him, but I roll a huge racing roll. And now we just get into a race where I was jinxing it. I was having you guys guess on error rates, but I jinxed it and he won a freak race. And then we have the double match point. Double three. This time he knew how to play his opening doubles. Of course, in the double match point, you just want to make the anchor and come down, unstacking the midpoint. That's the right idea. It's the right idea at most scores, except for gammon go, where you want to make inner points. 6-3, I could make the beautiful 5 point, but since my opponent already has an advanced anchor, I gotta come out and make the advanced anchor myself. Notice also that I'm up 2 pips in the race. Therefore, I want to have my back checkers more advanced than his. That's what gives me a small edge in this position. Let's see the winning chances. Okay, I'm actually 49%, 48% dog. Okay, fair enough. He hits a fly shot again. That's a big shot. Now I want to re-hit. I can't. Notice that I didn't bury a checker on the deuce point. It's simply too much to lose my last spare checker on the 8 and put it down on the useless deuce point in this position. I want to play flexible and I want to play pure. And even if he hits the 3, or if he misses the 3, I can use this checker here either to make the 7 point or to attack. Anyway, in all ways, efficiency, purity, flexibility, 13-7, it's just much better. The only argument for making the play 8-2 is safety, but all the other concepts are much more important in a double match point position like this one. I'm not playing gammon safe. 6-2. He could have run, and since he's up in the race, actually running is a very good play in double match point. He doesn't gain anything from the extra gammon value of making the 4 point in my face. Double deuce, that's good. 6-1. Oh yeah, double deuce was really good. Now I'm winning, but I failed to execute him with this roll. 5-2 is not good, but I survive, and he fans. What a horrible fan. Here I opted to make the prime rather than make the blitz. The blitz would be making the 3 point. That's a blitzing move, making inner points. I opted for the priming move, which is a much better game plan in double match points, since you don't gain anything from gammon wins. He fans again. 4-3, I the threes are duplicated since I would like to hit, but of course, what a beautiful point to make in my prime with 4-3. 5-3, that's actually pretty good because he gets to put his back checker on the edge of my prime, hopefully to make the anchor next time. And I get the beautiful 6 prime with 6-3. And now he's in a world of trouble. Let's see how big of a favorite I am after this one. Okay, he still has 16% wins after he enters and makes the ace point. His problem, however, is that he rolls too high. Extreme Gammon likes this contact move, trying to force a hit and improve flexibility. I think very few people would find that move. 5-3, notice this is a good play since I come up with both. Running with one would leave my blood on the 18 point, his 7 point, and I don't want him to hit and slot the bar point at the same time. I prefer him to hit out here and keep this gap on the 7 point. And furthermore, the threes are duplicated since you like to use the 3 to hit and the 3 to cover. That's some of the small details that goes into my thinking in these kinds of moves. Double deuces. Haha. The right idea is to force contact and don't move destructive pips down here. He moves, he makes this move 8-2, which is a bit destructive, and this one. I feel that, Extreme Gammon move. Force contact, play this one up, and then just slot some points here. Doesn't matter. Break some points, play flexible. 4-1, that's the problem. Double 5, that fucks up his position. And let's see, yeah, now I'm a 92% favorite in this game. Goes to show that when you're trapped in an ace point game and your timing is gone, you are really getting beaten up big time. Yeah, and I could just roll my prime forward. I have a 6 prime, and the only variable here is, am I scared of getting hit or not? And in this case, I'm not. He still has a gap on his 18 point, and he doesn't have the timing at all to contain and reprime my back checker. So when I'm not scared of getting hit and I have a 6 prime, I should just roll my prime forward, slot the point and roll the prime. He continues to crunch. I'm rolling my prime forward, continues to crunch, and we just get into a barren game like this. Notice that with the 5-1, I'm killing my sixes by putting the checker on the 7 point. That means every time I roll a 6, it's like rolling a 0, which gives me more time to keep my prime and therefore give him more time to crunch even more. So that's the idea with that move. 2-1, I just play flexible. Aha, forced move, he misses, he gets another chance, he hits. He misses, he hits. I fan, now he's catching up in the race. Actually, after my 2-1, he is winning 44% of the games. He got a big chance here. Yes, now I should hang back and maximize contact, because actually now I want to make a hit, and he has quite a few rolls that leaves a shot next time. He makes the pick and pass, huge roll, and then I get this huge 8 after the pick and pass. You can see that he's a 57% favorite. And after I get the 8 from the bar, I'm a 75% favorite. So that was a joker. Huge roll. And it's a race, and I end up winning. And this was the statistics. You see the error rates, grandmaster level, expert level. 1 checker play blunder, 4 checker play blunders. I was a little bit more lucky. He threw away twice as much equity as I did. And that's it. Okay, guys, that was the live stream of today. Hope you learned something. Go play at Backgammon Galaxy, and see you at the boards. Ciao.
Mm-hmm.